What if God has a purpose and a mission that supersedes everything we are going through today? What if God has got a plan for you that outweighs all the chaos and the strife and the hardship and the difficulty? What if God has got a church in the world today to achieve his purpose and his mission that supersedes everything we go to? What if one day you get to heaven and are able to say, I lived in Zimbabwe in the early 20s. And I faithfully extended the mission of God despite all of that. Can't really swear in church. But what if what this book says is true about what God is doing from beginning to end? And what if the devil has caused us to become so busy with everyday life, mundane things, or we've been caught up in the rat race? And there was a prophetic word in our prayer meeting this morning that there's a fog over the church, that we can't see what God is doing, much like you see the haze of the August sky at the moment. What if it's true? God is outworking his purposes from beginning to end. Would it change your life? Would you do things differently? Would you have different priorities or different ways you do stuff? What if? We've been going through a church series called Church in Action. And we've seen the different values within our church that create our culture. And the culmination of all these values being we're people of the Word, and we're people of the Spirit, and we're people of the kingdom, and we're a community, a family together. All of these four culminate in this final one today called the mission of God. Because it's all useless. It's all playing church if these values don't catalyze us onto the mission for which Christ died. Does Jesus look on us and think, guys, you've missed it? You come along to church, you sing some songs, you go home in time to make sure the Sunday roast is not burnt. Guys, you've missed it. Today we're looking at the mission of God. What is it that God is doing that we could have missed, that we could have been clouded by the chaos of the world we live in? I believe God wants to lift our eyes above the chaos, above the trials, above the difficulties, above the hardship to see his mission. And that will change us. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we pray this morning that you would lift our eyes to see what you saw in the beginning when you said, let us make man in our image. To see what you look forward to on that final day when every tribe and tongue and nation is gathered around the throne worshiping. Lord Jesus, would you open our eyes? Would you cause us to see your purpose and your mission in the world today? And be willing to lay our lives down for that cause above every other thing that calls upon our time and resources. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. I want us to understand a principle primarily that's run throughout the scripture this morning that helped me tremendously to give my life for the church. I look back over 20, 25, 30 years of work, And I said, wow, if I had become an accountant, I could be wealthy by now, I'm sure. Or if I had become a farmer, or if I had, you know, done gold mining or something. But there was something that caught me when I was very young that said, you give your life for the church. And I trust today that you'll see a little bit of what God did in me. I don't even know how many years ago now, 35 or something crazy. And it comes initially, Genesis 12, 1 to 3. I want us to read this scripture first. It's right at the beginning. We saw last week, right at the beginning of Genesis, God said, let us make man in our image. And then after creation, there was the fall and the flood. Remember, the world became so evil that God destroyed all mankind except for one family. And then from that, we have the calling of Abram, who became Abraham. And God said to him, now the Lord said to Abraham, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. And I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great, so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and him who dishonors you I will curse. And you, and in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. This is called the Abrahamic covenant, if you like, and it follows on the one about look up and see the stars. Can you count them? So shall your people be. And this was just an ordinary guy, Abram, and God called him to fulfill his purpose in the world. What was God's purpose? You see it first here, a people of God. God says, I will call you and I will make you into a great nation and I will bless you. The very first thing about the purpose of God is that he has a people in the earth. All of this was created. Everything you see, everything he made was in order for God to have a people in the earth. That's why he made Adam and Eve. And that's where we get to here. And he calls this little guy Abram and he says, come on my mission. I want a people that will be my people in the earth. And he says, I will bless you. And those that curse you, I will curse. And those that bless you, I will bless. So right at the very beginning, the very first thing we see in the calling of God is that he has a people and he calls his people to himself. What does it mean to be a people? Firstly, it's a commitment God makes to them. I love these verses that it says, I will bless you. I will protect you. I will keep you. It's nothing that they have to do except obey. And the verse after this, it just says, Abram obeyed the Lord and he went. But a commitment is this relationship we have, God committing to us and us in obedience committing to God, that gives us our identity as the people of God. The primary thing that God has in the world is a people. And secondly, from that identity comes our purpose, comes what he's called us to do. And from the very beginning in Genesis, God says, the reason my people exist on the earth is to be a blessing to the nations. This just broke me at Bible college, age 24, 25. God has a people in the earth that from that people, he wants to bless all nations. He wants his people to be a blessing to all nations. Because of that, he says, if they curse you or if they dishonor you, I will curse them. If they honor you, I will bless them, and you will be a blessing to all nations. And this principle runs throughout the Old Testament and even into the New Testament. You see it popping up everywhere. God often says, I will be your God, and you will be my people. Whenever he speaks to Israel, which were his people, the ones he chose in the Old Testament, he says, I will be your God, you will be my people. And the purpose for that relationship and that commitment is for the blessing of others. To grasp this in the world today is so significant. There's something that's calling you to, that's calling for your attention and time and efforts and energies and monies. There's always something that's calling on your priorities. Yet to realize God has a people and his people have a purpose to be a blessing. You see it throughout the Old Testament. The Ten Commandments. Have you ever noticed the Ten Commandments? The first four or five are about the relationship we have with God, our commitment, our relationship to God. honor God, have no other idols, keep the Sabbath. And then the second five are about our relationship with other people, how we are a blessing to others. Do not steal, do not commit adultery, do not covet your neighbor's donkey. How many of you got donkeys in your neighbor's house? But the same principle runs through the Ten Commandments: commitment to God and relationship to God and relationship to other people. Jesus, when he walked on the earth, he exemplified this, his identity leading to his purpose. Remember when he was baptized, God says, "This is my son whom I love. With him I am well pleased." It's the identity, the relationship he has with his heavenly Father that propels him into his purpose to live a sinless life and to die a death for all mankind. And Jesus asked, what's the greatest commandment? What's your purpose on the earth? What are we supposed to be doing, Lord Jesus, on the earth? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, relationship, identity. Love your neighbor as yourself, a blessing to all nations. Be a blessing to the people around you. And Jesus says, all the other commandments, all the law and the prophets hang on these two things: an initial identity, a people, a relationship with God that leads to a purpose, to love your neighbor as yourself. And so this flows throughout the scriptures. You see this principle that people of God, the identity we have in Christ, give us our purpose in him. And it culminates in the Great Commission. And it's a wonderful piece of scripture, Matthew 28, 18 to 20. I'm sure you know it well if you've been around church long enough. But it's packed with incredible identity and purpose. The disciples, they would have seen Jesus. They would have lived with Jesus. They saw his death and his resurrection. He's alive. And Jesus says, go up to the hill and I'll meet you there, or the mountain. Jesus meets them on the mountain, and it says this: and Jesus came to them and said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all I have commanded you, and behold, I am with you always to the very end of the age. And you see these guys, there's only 11 of them left, and these are Jesus' disciples. Their primary identity, disciple of Jesus. When these guys walked into a supermarket or to a garage to top up their Camel or whatever it was, people knew these 11 were the disciples of Christ. These are the ones who've been with Jesus for 3 years. They have an identity. They have a relationship. Jesus didn't choose an army. He didn't say, right, these 300 I'm going to work with over the next 3 years. He chose 12, and he ended up with 11. The identity was, I'm a disciple of Christ. And then their purpose came out of that. That when they saw his death and resurrection, and just before he was transcended up to heaven, transfigured, he gives them this commission to make disciples of all nations. And from there, these 11 guys outwork the purposes of God across the earth. From their identity as disciples, God says, your purpose now is to make disciples of all nations. I don't know how you would have felt. You know, it became a little bit uncomfortable when I challenged you at the beginning this morning, and that's 250 of you. Can you imagine 11 of them hearing the Lord Jesus Christ? All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Therefore, you go and make disciples of all nations. But what actually happened is from these 11, the church is established after the filling of the Holy Spirit. Remember he said, wait in Jerusalem, you guys. I know you can't do it by yourselves. Filling of the Holy Spirit, and slowly but surely, the church is established. And the rest of the Bible, essentially, is the narrative, the historical narrative of the establishment of the church and the outworking of this great commission by these 11 guys. I think that's so incredible. If you've ever felt, I don't really have much to give, or I'm a little bit inadequate for what God is calling me to do, imagine these guys, 11 of them, and the Lord Jesus saying to them, make disciples of all nations. But yet, through the power of the Spirit, they faithfully got to work and did it. And the famous camp story that I grew up hearing, Holiday In and Holiday Out, is that the story of when Jesus gets back to heaven. After this, he gets back to heaven and the angel Gabriel's there and he's, Jesus, you're back. Welcome home. So good to have you back. Did you really live a sinless life on earth? Yes, Gabriel, I lived a sinless life. Wow, Jesus. And did you really die on a cross for the sins of all mankind? Is it really true, Jesus? Yes, Gabriel, I gave my life, I died. And I was laid in a tomb and I rose from the dead. And Jesus, is it true that the gospel, that people who put their faith and their trust in you can be forgiven and come to heaven and be with us? Yes, Gabriel, it's true. That's why I went. Jesus, how will the people know on the earth now that you're back here? Well, Gabriel, I left 11 disciples and a few women faithfully followed me. It's their job to tell the world. Gabriel steps back and says, Lord Jesus, what about in the year 2023 when there's 7 billion people on the earth? How will those 11 have told them? He says, well, Gabriel, it's the same plan. I'll have a few people in each country, a few people in each suburb, a few people who are my disciples in each family, in each school, in each office. Across the world, I'll have a few disciples. It's their job to tell them. Jesus, one more question. What if they don't tell them? Jesus looked at him and said, Gabriel, I have no other plan. And I remember being told that as a kid, as a teenager, that we are the plan. Disciples of Jesus Christ, those who would put their faith in Christ and call themselves followers of Christ, it's our job to tell them. And it's so challenging. The other thing that inspired me more recently in my 20s when I decided to go into the church in full-time work is the fact that at the end of the Bible, Revelation 2, Jesus appears again to John. And what's amazing is John was one of those 11 on the hill who saw Jesus and he said, go and make disciples. Then Jesus went up and 70 years passes and John is now on the island of Patmos and he sees a vision, and the vision he sees becomes the book of Revelation. And that second chapter, John sees the risen Christ. He sees a picture of what Jesus looks like now. And it's an amazing description. His eyes are like fire. He wears robes of righteousness. His voice is like thunder of mighty waters. And John hears the same voice. He remembers it. Go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them. And then the same voice is saying, and he's petrified. He falls down as if dead. You can read it in Revelation 2. Why is he petrified? One is he sees the glory of Jesus, and we will all fall on our faces one day when we see him in his glory. But the other one, he must have been thinking, he's going to ask me about what we did, the 11 of us, since we were told to make disciples of all nations. What have we done? The Bible says Jesus lays his hand on him and he says, stand up. I want to tell you a few things. Write a letter to the churches. And you see the picture of Jesus walking amongst golden lampstands. Each lampstand, golden, is a church in a suburb somewhere in the known world that John knew. Jesus is walking amongst them. And it's exactly the same today. Jesus walks amongst the churches. He walks amongst his people. In Revelation, he speaks to each church by name. He knows their names, he knows their strengths, he knows their weaknesses. He says, I'm upset with this. I want you to do this. It's exactly the same today. Jesus has a church in each suburb, in each nation, more and more. And those churches are made up of disciples who are commissioned to tell other people. And this is the plan. Jesus has no other plan except his church, made up of his disciples who are given the Great Commission to tell other people and make disciples of all nations. These two things changed my life when I understood this for the first time. That firstly, there's no other plan. Jesus is not going to come back to declare his gospel again. He's coming back for his church, for his bride, for those who've put their faith and trust in him. And yet, he has a people, a church, that he is working through in every suburb, in every city, in every nation, more and more across the world. And this is the mission of God. And so, River of Life Church, we have this final value, mission. And you would have seen it on your bookmarks. I've got it here somewhere. There we go. You should have got one of these at the beginning with all the different values we have. And this value 14, the mission of God, wholeheartedly owning our vision to be a people on a worldwide mission. A church who's fully involved in the shared apostolic vision to extend the kingdom of God globally. You know, we're part of a worldwide family of churches, New Frontiers. There's thousands of churches across the world that, as Gus said, if you walked into one of those churches today, you would see the same values and you would feel at home. I've been there. I've been to churches in Brighton, in the UK, in South Africa, in Turkey. You just feel like it's River of Life. We're part of a family of churches across the world. And we're just one family. And there's families of churches, families of families across the world. And that's before you get to the denominational churches, the size of the Anglican Church and the different churches across the world with Bible-believing people. We're part of that. And our value as River of Life is to commit wholeheartedly to be part of that, to do the recovery of New Testament church life, making disciples, training leaders, planting churches by all means, including financial commitment, welcoming translocal ministries, people coming in and out and serving, regularly attending our corporate gatherings, promoting our publications, and communicating our news. That's who we are when we join in the mission of God. And you know, River of Life, we've got so much to give. God has established us as a church over the last 25, 26 years. We believe wholeheartedly now that God is beginning to launch us as a church to be a blessing to the nations. We've got people, we've got resources, we've got ministries like the worship ministry. I look forward to the worship guys beginning to minister and help other churches. You saw the children's work. Helen was so humble when she came up and said, Children of Hope. Yes, it's an international ministry that's coming into Zimbabwe, but it's been birthed through River of Life. The prison ministry, the youth ministries, the camps we run, the different things we do. River of Life, God has platformed to be a blessing. And through that, Disciple Nations has been born over the last 10 or so years. And Disciple Nations is our family of churches within Southern Africa, Zimbabwe, Mozambique, Zambia. We're just planting a church in Rwanda at the moment. The Zambians are going faster than us. And they've got thousands of churches that are looking to us and saying, we need material. We want your stuff. We want your people. And I know Scott and I and others and the apostolic team, we sit there and say, how are we going to do this? It's just, we're just little River of Life in Harare. We don't have what these people are calling for. But this is what God is calling us to do, to be a blessing to the nations. And you're a part of that. Our greatest resource is the gifting of our people sitting in this room. I promise you, I see people day in, day out, each week, with incredible gifting that they're just hiding under a little bush and scared, you know. Can you give a notice? Oh, I'm not sure I can do a notice on Sunday yet. I believe God has called you to preach to the nations. So would you consider this? It's one of our primary values to be wholeheartedly committed to the DNA churches, to the apostolic call that God has given us. Apostolic simply means sent. Simply means God is taking River of Life and he's sending us to be a blessing. In the early 2000s, we had a prophetic word over our church. You will be a grace-sending base. And I've always remembered that River of Life will be a grace-sending base. And then value 15, particularly regarding the poor and the needy, the vulnerable, you know, the orphans, the widows. Our nation is full of people who are struggling to make ends meet. That we would be a local church that preaches the gospel and empowers the poor. And then the one that I'm so excited about as River of Life is the number, is it 16? Yeah. The final one, that we would be a diverse church. That if we're heading to every tribe and tongue and nation gathered around the throne, his church will also be different tribes and tongues and genders and demographic groups. And that as a church, what brings us together is our unity around Christ, and what Danny preached last week, as the community of God. But that River of Life would be a church of diversity. We must celebrate this. Friends, this is what God has given us. When he spoke to the churches in Revelation, he said, I love this about your church. I believe when he speaks to River of Life, he would say, I love your diversity. And yes, sometimes you have indibele words that go right across the whole screen. New Varungu, you can't even start the first syllable. But we celebrate that. The fact that I can't speak indibele, I celebrate that. We must be a church of diversity. There's other churches in Harare who come to me and say, Andrew, how do you do it? How do you? I said, God has done it. Only God can do that. You know, countries try, political parties try, sports teams try. They try to get that, but only in God's family and God's church can you have a diversity that we see in his church. Because it's part of the Great Commission. It's part of the outworking of the purpose of God, that every tribe and tongue and nation will be gathered around the throne. That's what we celebrate as the mission of God in our church. So can I challenge you today? Firstly, to think personally. What has God given me? What is my identity? We have an identity in Christ, that when you put your faith in him, you become a child of God. You become one in whom there's no condemnation. You wear robes of righteousness. That's our identity as an individual. And we all have that. But God would have given you individual gifting and ability and talent that only you can do in the context you live in. Maybe in your family, maybe in your school or your staff room, your workplace. Maybe a gifting in business and finance. Gifting in preaching and teaching, gifting in music and the arts, possibly in sport. He would say, that's the identity I've given you, not for your own glory, not for your own goodness, not for your own fame. It's for the blessing of other people, the blessing of the nations. Identity always is for purpose, always for the blessing of other people. What is it that God's given you? I think many of us have just got into, like I said, the rat race of life, the busyness, the hardship, the difficulty it is just to make ends meet in our nation. We've taken our eyes off the purpose. God has given me this specific gift in order for his kingdom, for the blessing of other people. What is it as a family? You know, as a couple, a mum and dad or a couple of children, what is our purpose? What has God given us as a family in order to be a blessing to the nation or the people around us? I believe God calls families to a purpose and to a mission. And he calls churches. What is it that God has called River of Life at this time in this nation for? What is that purpose? Now ask us just to close our eyes and consider these three things. As an individual, what is your identity in Christ? You're a child of God. There's now no condemnation for you who are in Christ. You may have made mistakes. You may have a past which you're not happy about. You have regrets. Jesus says, I forgive your sin, past, present, and future. I remember it no more. you come to Christ and say, Lord Jesus, you know, you don't know what I've done. He says, I do, but I've forgotten it. I choose to remember it no more. He gives you a new identity. He's given you gifting and ability and education, a training. It's not for your own goodness, or your own glory. Yes, it may pay the bills and provide for you, but it's for His glory and the blessing of the nations, the blessing of the people around you. As a family, what has God put in your heart as a husband and wife, as children around your table? The purpose, the identity as a family, what has God called us to do? And as a church, Father, we thank you for River of Life. Thank you for the beauty of this body, the beauty of all that you've created here in worship and in children's ministry, in home groups and small groups. We thank you, Lord, that you've put us together for a purpose, for your mission. We thank you, Lord, that you've called us to backbone the DNA family of churches, to support this mission across Southern Africa and to Zimbabwe and Zambia and Mozambique and Rwanda. Oh, Jesus, we look at it as a church and think, really, us, River of Life? We thank you that those 11 disciples went on to establish a worldwide church. We ask for that same work in 2023, 24, these years that we'll be together. We thank you that you have a church, the people of God, for the blessing of the nations. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Amen.